breaking news out of Louisville, Kentucky. Police now confirm a gunman shot six people at a park during a youth football game.
On Saturday, three men were found dead inside this home on Lewis Coleman Drive. One of them has been identified as Michael Bass, who lived at the home. The other two, John.
Fast. Last night I cut the light off in the bedroom, hit the switch, was in the bed before the room was dark.
Incredible.
Fast.
Incredible.
Situation, like being in an area where people are getting shot, like being able to get out of that and just not being that person to like succumb to that environment, and like it just shows you that it is possible, no matter where you're from, no matter what you're going through, no matter how hard it seems, like trust me, there's a way out. I grew up in Louisville, Kentucky, and not the greatest area.
Don't get shot out of my area, there ain't no trauma units. If you were snaking, they ain't do it, just know the ops are doing it. Go and drill, this the best time, cause the ops are to it.
There's a huge story. I was in Louisville, I was in middle school, and my mom was at work. I was with my cousin. My cousin was watching us, my mom was at work. It was like an off day or like a holiday or something. And so I had to do a project for like a project at school. I had to go to the library. So I was at my cousin's house. My apartment where we stayed with my mom was around the corner. So
I came here first to get my library card, and I was here for like 20 minutes. I left, started walking to the library. I got to the library. I got what I needed to get. I was coming back. And I remember I was on Broadway, I'm like right by the library, and I'm walking back and I see all these ambulances like speeding by. And I don't know why, but in my head, they could have been going anywhere. Like, cause they weren't even near my apartment yet. They could have been going anywhere. I was just like,
please don't be going to like my house. Like, don't be going near where I'm going. And I walk all the way home. I get there. My apartment is literally roped off in caution tape.
So probably around like 4 or 5 o'clock, two cats came down, and they had looked in, from people telling us, they had looked in our mail slot and was knocking on our door to see if anybody was in the house. And luckily, like I said, nobody was there. So they had went next door and started to knock on their door and went through their mail slot. And one of the people that lived there actually came to look through the hole and asked, like, who's here? Because it was covered up. They said the peephole was covered up. And as soon as he said like his first words, who is it, they just started shooting through the door, and had killed this dude named, I think his name was Chris, maybe Chris King, that used to play football for Central. Just killed him in the matter of 5 seconds for no reason.
I was literally here like 10 minutes before that happened, and I was like in middle school, I was in 8th grade, and like he could have shot through the door and killed me.
We were staying with like everyone that I could think of, like as far as our family. Like, I think that when we lived in Louisville, I think there was one point in my entire like time there, from about 6th grade all the way through high school, where we stayed in our own place, like our own apartment.
550 apartments. We're actually in the hallway, kind of where I grew up. I spent a little bit of my life here. This is my grandma's place. A lot of the times I stay with my grandma, just 'cause my mom, you know, single parent. 3 kids, trying to pay rent, just always didn't happen. So I remember we stayed here. I was in probably in middle school, and we stayed here with my grandma, my 2 cousins, and then it was me, my brother, sister, and my mom. It's like a 3-bedroom apartment, so can imagine how crammed it was. You know, sleeping on couches, floors, all kinds of stuff. So that's it right there.
Part of my grandma's role was just like her kind of being that second caretaker for us, because we stayed with her like all the time. Even when I was in college, like my mom was still staying with my grandmother. So when I go home, like I would go to my grandma's house.
Yeah. Look at him. He's just handsome, boy.
How are you?
How are you, sweetie?
I'm good.
Oh, look good.
How you been?
I'm hanging in here.
Hey.
Still hanging around. Like most kids growing up in the hood, like it's either like basketball or football. Just because like when you think about it, just economically those sports are just super easy to like access. Like you find a hoop, you buy a basketball, you're a basketball player, you know. So I think that I always wanted to be going that path, but when I got to high school and I started to run fast, I knew that track was gonna pay my bills. Like, track was gonna get me through college. Track was going to, really that was the main thing, was just getting me through college so I can be, you know, have a degree. So I knew that that was kind of my avenue. And so I think I really like invested myself into it in high school and really started to take it serious around my junior year of high school.
Ronnie was always the fastest on the team, and not just that, he was probably the most athletic, so he was always the best defender. So you never ever wanted to go up against Ronnie in full court one-on-one, because he would dust you and then he'd take your rock. Like, it was just, you never wanted to do that.
Let's go, Ronnie.
So genuinely, we realized he was that talented early. It wasn't until junior year of high school when he was breaking state records that we were like, you should probably focus on track.
It was a state meet. I'm pretty sure his junior year is state meet. And you know, track in Louisville, Kentucky wasn't really hyped as much as it is in other cities and states. But when I feel like when my brother was running, it was around the same time this dude named James Quick was running. So, and everybody, he was already talked about, you know what I'm saying, a little bit before my brother, because he was already fast. His speed was pretty good. And everybody's up against the fence, like, hold on, this is finna be like the race of the year right here. I'm like, what? You know what I'm saying? I'm looking down there like, hold on, that's big bro down there in the block. So, you know what I'm saying? They get ready, do their thing. And next thing you know, the gun goes out. Race starts off close. It's real close. And I'm already surprised because me not even knowing my brother's that fast. He's getting out with the big dudes, you know what I'm saying? So he's a junior at this time. So he's running, you know what I'm saying? They get about 40 meters away from finish line and he just takes off. And I'm just looking like eyes big, like, hold on, that's big bros. The only thing I do after that is I just start going crazy. I'm yelling, you know what I'm saying? Posting them on social media, I'm recording everything. Everybody's looking like, oh, that's your bro. I'm like, yeah, bro. Like, he's fast. He do this. You know what I'm saying? That was really my first time seeing him run. It just surprised me. And ever since then, like, we got to the spot that night, and it's crazy because we just go to the room, and I'm just sitting there looking at him like, like, bro, you just beat, like, one of the best dudes in track right now. You know what I'm saying?
When he became a senior and then he was getting all these letters and calls from different schools, that's when it really hit me. I'm like, wow, my son, I mean, I knew he was good, but I didn't realize how good he was. I didn't realize that he could earn a scholarship, a full ride to college. And that was the turning point for myself, and I think for him also, because he was saying, wow, this is something really serious. I can make it, you know, with this. I can, like, basically, I don't know if he thought, you know, maybe I can get out of the ghetto, you know. I don't know what he was thinking, but he knew that he was onto something.
You're the oldest and you're listening to this, like, you know that the weight is on your shoulders. And I feel like my mom learned a lot through me, because, you know, with the first kid, like, I guess you don't really know all the stuff that's gonna happen. And then, you know, the first kid always messes up first, And so I think that it helped my mom grow a lot. But for me, man, just being an example, because I have never been a vocal leader, and I still to this day am not really a vocal leader. Like, I always lead just by example. I do what's right, I do what I know I'm supposed to do, and I just expect, like, if people are gonna, they're just gonna follow me, they're gonna just copy what I do and make themselves, you know, better. And so I try to do that for my younger two siblings, is just be an example.
Y'all notice how these are on my
shoes? Yeah, that's why. What?
I
didn't know these were on
your shoes.
What are you doing here?
Because this is my house.
What?
What? I'm like, bro, hold on. Then I look.
With everything I do, I have to think about them and say, okay, is this going to be something that I would want them to do, or is this something that I want them to see, or just look at it in that perspective. And so the weight is definitely on my shoulders. And even being, you know, when I was younger and just having my mom around, I had to do a lot of stuff as a, you know, teenager that, like, most teenagers wouldn't do.
He would literally make sure I was doing everything I was supposed to do in school. When I got home, you know, before I hop on the game or anything like that, make sure I get my big priorities out the way first, you know what I'm saying? And just from watching him, even on TV, because, you know, we don't stay together that much now because he's living in Texas. But even watching him on TV, just every time I see him, I see him and I just want to do good, you know what I'm saying? Because I feel like I have a shoe, you know, to put my foot in, you know what I'm saying? I gotta make sure there's enough room for me in that shoe. You know, I gotta fill that shoe out, and it's not easy. You know what I'm saying? Cause he's that man. Like, he's out here doing his thing. You know what I'm saying?
Even as I was going to school, trying to pursue my nursing career, my son inspired me a lot of times. I would come home from work, I would know that I had homework to do, chapters to read, but I was exhausted. I would come home and I'd come in, and my child, as Ronnie, was up doing his homework after a long day. He started his day like 5 o'clock that morning. Get up, get himself ready, get his sister and brother up, make sure they're together. While I slept sometimes, a little late, get them out, they would get out to school. He would go to classes all throughout the day, then have practice or maybe a game, come home and still did all this homework. I would think, I'm not doing any homework when I get home. I have to walk past my child's room. Like I said, he was up doing his homework. I'm like, Ronnie, what are you doing? He's like, Mom, oh, I'm just reading. I have to read my last three chapters of such and such book, or I'm doing my math, I'm writing a report. He goes, I'm almost finished though, I won't be up too much longer. I said, okay, because you need to get your rest, you got to get up early for school tomorrow. He goes, yes ma'am, I know. And that would inspire me. I'm like, I can't even go to bed, I gotta read something, I gotta do something. My kid can go through this whole day and do all this, and he still can come home and get off his work. I gotta do it. So he would inspire me a lot.
Well, Ronnie, if you had to tell our listeners one thing that you would want them to know about you and what you're trying to accomplish, what would that be before we go to break?
Oh man, the biggest thing for me is just really being the best Ronnie Baker that I can. I feel like a lot of people, they try to put me in that category with Usain and like, oh, who's gonna be the next guy? And I feel like I've been watching Usain Bolt, and I've seen his documentary, and I know what he's done. Really, like, that category is like, it's a category of its own. It's almost like saying, trying to compare, you know, the LeBrons and the Kobes to Jordan. You know, it's like, Jordan, he was great, and I feel like he's kind of in his own bubble almost. Just by the way he changed the game and how he played it. And I feel like Usain Bolt is just so iconic that he's in his own bubble. There's no one that's gonna be like, replace him, you know what I'm saying? Right. So it's just like Muhammad Ali, you know, right. you don't say,
well, okay.
you don't put someone in that right. category. And I feel like that's kind of where he's at. And I think for me, it's just to be the best Ronnie Baker that I can be, potentially, you know, break records, break world records, break American records, all those things. But at the end of the day, it's gonna be you know, people are going to remember me as Ronnie Baker, not as the person that replaced Usain Bolt.
Yeah, but here's the deal. You're now getting to the status of being an elite runner. Mm-hmm. So you have to think in those terms that, hey, that's where I want to go.
Yeah.
Okay? This is the first time I met you, a very humble young man, but you're almost there, okay? You can still keep that humbleness.
Time to take him down, coach. Tell him.
Yes, sir. Okay?
Yeah, I totally get that. I understand.
Okay.
Sure.
Time to take him down, Ronnie.
All of my friends in Louisville, Kentucky, where I started. I'm recognized all over the world now, but my greatness came and started in Louisville, Kentucky. And that's one of the greatest cities in America, Louisville, Kentucky. And I predict that Louisville, Kentucky will have another world champion, because Louisville is the greatest.
A barrier is always the mental aspect of everything. It's convincing yourself that it is possible, that you can do it, and you can. Whatever it is that you want to do, whatever it is that you want to accomplish, like, you can do that.
All right, so you're going to TCU. I mean, what really appealed? What was appealing about TCU? Because you picked it over Ohio State, UCLA, some top schools.
Well, TCU, I mean, I wanted to get out of the state, that was one thing, and then also, again, weather's great there. The academics is awesome at TCU. They're actually moving to they're moving to the Big 12 this year, so it'll be some good competition in the Big 12 track. And scholarship money.
That's awesome, man. So this is definitely, like I said, you got the 400 day, we'll see, you got prom, so we don't know about that 200, so. That 200, that's where James Quick seems to be, that seems to be his event, so, I mean, let's see what happens, man.
Yep, we'll see what happens.
All right, man, congratulations.